Our guests this week are Julian Temple, film director and video maker, best known for the Sex Pistols and McLaren movie, The Great Rock and Roll Swindle, who's shortly flying to Mexico, maybe, to make a new video for The Stones. Mark Armand of the critically acclaimed Soft Cell and more critically abused Mark and the Mambas. And Annabelle Lamb, the singer-songwriter who currently has a hit with someone else's song, The Doors' old classic, Riders on the Storm. We're going to be looking at a new album from Gary Newman, a single from Susie and the Banshees, and a film with a soundtrack album that's the follow-up to the best-selling album of all time. That was the claim made for Saturday Night Fever, and now comes Staying Alive, which seemed to me is not so much a Saturday Night Fever 2, but a mixture of Flashdance and Fame and a bit of a Sunday morning hangover as far as some of the music's concerned. Here's one of the dance scenes. Here's some of the drama. John Travolta is upset at his girlfriend's interest in a musician played by Frank Stallone, who just happens to be the brother of the director, Sylvester Stallone.
I didn't think he was going to show up.
Look, I'm really sorry to show in late tonight. Oh, Tony, you remember Carl? Carl, this is Tony.
Yeah, how you doing?
Look, I need to ask you something.
That guy's a musician.
Yeah.
I don't think he was a musician type. I never thought
Come on, Tony. You know he plays rhythm guitar at the club. He walked me over
rhythm
here.
Rhythm guitar?
Rhythm guitar.
Oh, man, that's the worst. Oh, it's absolute worst. Man, everybody in the world knows you can't trust a guy who plays rhythm guitar.
Oh, I can't.
Look, underneath them curls a pervert. I can feel it.
Did you take funny pills today or something?
Oh, forget it.
How did you get in here?
The window. Look, I don't
You amaze me.
I don't like him. I wouldn't trust him. He looks like some demented paratrooper.
He is just a friend. Hey, listen, thanks, Carl.
Sorry, is everything all right? Everything is fine. She's in good hands. Hey, what are you, Allstate, pal? Yeah, you want disability?
Look, I'll see you Wednesday, okay?
All right. Good night.
Good night.
Julian, it's presumably going to be a box office smash here. Does it deserve to be one?
Well, if it was up to me, I'd call it Staying Awake, I think. It's one of those films that is just very hard to sit through. You know, it's a reworking of the old story of a backstage Broadway love triangle, with the only added ingredients of, you know, the current body fetishism and the narcissism of John Travolta. 80% of the thing is a voyeuristic look at a kind of a series of pineapple dance rehearsals, and you have a better time standing in Langley Street, looking through the window at the dancers, you know. I mean, it's so badly shot. Even the climax of the thing, where the sound suddenly bursts into stereo, is shot like Top of the Pops. It's a reworking of the whole Arlene Phillips writhing bodies and bleached, black-combed hair, and the old bondage cliches dragged out.
So you didn't rate Sylvester Stallone as a director?
Not at all, or his brother as a musician either. I mean, I think...
Or an actor.
Or an actor. No, I mean, that whole thing of the overextended Italian family relationships in Hollywood films really doesn't work, I don't think.
Mark, what about the music?
Well, I thought it was incredibly dated, and It's nothing, really. I think its only appeal of the film as a whole would be to just Wallies who are looking for an alternative to that tatty old white suit that they've got hanging up in the wardrobe. And in America, it'd be perfect Valley Girl fodder as well. You know, you can sort of, it's just, it's terribly naff, really. And judging by Mr. Revolta's recent interviews, where he bares all but his brains, I think that he and Tony Manero are really the same character. There's no character playing at all, where he makes such comments as, oh yeah, I like girls with long legs, big breasts, small waists and big butts. You know, he's such a chauvinistic idiot, basically. And
Annabelle, did you find him a chauvinistic idiot?
No, okay, guys. I enjoyed it.
You were charmed?
I was charmed, not necessarily by him. But I went straight to my rehearsals after seeing it.
Your dance rehearsals?
My band rehearsals for my tour. I got there and my band wondered what had happened to me. I was going, hey, let's go on. I felt great. I mean, I felt great. And I think there's nothing wrong with a film that makes people feel good. The plot was completely pointless. I agree with you. I don't like Travolta in those roles. I think he was very good in Blowout.
So what made you feel good?
Which I saw. Just the general atmosphere of it. I think if you're... I mean, it's all very well talking about Langley Street, but not all of us live in London and can go and watch Through the Window of the Pineapple. And I think it's very much a teen-orientated audience. But in that way, that's fine. It would make kids feel great. And anyone who wants to be a dancer would love it. The dancing is excellent.
I don't agree.
It masquerades the dancing. You don't get a chance to see the dancing. There's one cut every 0.9 seconds.
He approaches every dance routine with like he's about to do a karate chop on a block of concrete.
But the camera never lets you see the dance.
Oh, listen, it's not The Stalker, I agree, but it's a family entertainment film.
But it is a problem.
Gary Newman started an extensive British tour yesterday, the first home dates he's played in 2.5 years. It's 4 years now since he started making bestsellers like Our Friends Electric and Cars, and since then he's been praised as a great innovator of the brave new synthesized world, but also derided somewhat for his silly image. That image isn't helped much by the cover of his new album Warriors, on which he looks like a leather-clad heavy, sulking because his hair's just been dyed the wrong colour. Still, here's the title track. New funkies, more funky style from Mr. Newman there?
Yes, well, the trouble is that you can't tell where the fake tan ends and the hairline begins. And and if his aim was to make an utterly sort of disposable alternative to an ashtray, sort of devoid of any heart, soul, emotion, wit, style, or anything, then he's made a very successful record.
But one thing it has
got plenty of is humour, but I think it's very one-sided. My side, and because I think that he's totally serious,
You've got very serious musicians playing on there. Well, yes. Bill Nelson and Dick Morrissey, people like that.
They should know
there.
Better. And he seems to be sort of very sort of... he seems to be in his own little world, totally sort of obsessive and in his own world. Nothing else outside of it exists and fine, you know. But, I mean, it's just like... The songs are very well produced. The sound's very crisp and precise, but... There's no ups and downs. They just all go along on one level, sort of usually ending off meandering, and occasionally he comes in to do a vocal, just sounding like he's just sort of swallowed a whole bottle of Mogadons before the session.
Annabelle, do you agree with that? You like it?
I don't like the image very much. No.
What about the music?
I agree with Mark about that very much. I think the music, a lot of it has been done so much, so often. We've heard it all before, but what I was pleased was what you were saying about hearing Dick Morrissey. I love the two tracks on side one, I Am Render, and the one after it, Iceman, which have a great deal
ones.
Of atmosphere, yeah. More jazz, less of the dead straight along electronic. I mean, it's nice to hear him actually mixing it now, but I found it, again, it did go along level-wise.
Do you think it's right that he should be treated as a great innovator?
Probably not as a great innovator. I think he was an innovator.
All the synthesized stuff that came after.
Yes, I think it's cruel to say that it's all completely on one level.
I think he just hasn't tried, or he just doesn't care. He likes to be referred to as a rock star, sort of in inverted commas. But there's just no caring in this.
He's
just like he's given the cover to the record company art department, saying, "Here, let's see what you can make of this." I think it all says it all in the elastic cuffs of his scuffless leather bomber jacket.
I have to say,
Julian,
I couldn't get beyond laughing at the cover. I couldn't get the record out of the sleeve. I was laughing so much at the cover. Really.
I don't think he cares. There's no caring or no. Or anything shown there. It's that, we've got to make an album, I'll get a few good musicians to back me up. But it's like about 7 or 8 years on now for Gary Newman, and you should be expecting sort of a few more sort of surprises and a few more sort of...
An originator? He was a David Bowie clone, and you've been force-fed so much David Bowie this year that there's no room at all for... Mr. Newman.
On the whole, then, a hefty thumbs down for Mr. Gary Newman. Susie and the Banshees are back from their long, jolly summer holes, in which Susie and Budgie had fun being the creatures, while Steve Severin played with The Cure's Robert Smith in The Glove. Their album, Blue Sunshine, had echoes of late Beatlish psychedelia, and there's more of that on the new Banshees single, a version of Lennon and McCartney's Dear Prudence from the 68 White Album. Here's how it's been treated 15 years on.
Greet the brand new day for me. Hey,
Prudence in Venice for some reason. Annabelle, you've just had a hit with a 60s classic, previously identified very strongly with a well-known male singer. Do you think Susie's going to do the same thing with this?
I expect so, yes, very much so. I mean, I love Susie, but it's an interesting comparison because I noticed with her that it's pretty obvious that it's a song that she loves particularly. It must be, because she could have covered just about any Beatles song, and she didn't. She chose that one. And that was the same story with me. And I think that's always a good thing. If you're going to do a cover that you particularly love. Don't just pick something just for the hell of it.
Isn't it frightening covering something that's been done brilliantly before?
So, I know, it's so funny. People said to me after I'd done Riders on the Storm, it's a bit brave doing a Doors song. It never occurred to me, that's the truth. Until I'd done it, and people started pointing it out to me.
This one seems a bit gentle for a Banshee song.
Yes, I found it a bit, it's a bit over psychedelic in places, maybe, I feel. I love the B-side. The B-side Tattoo is great. And much more like Susie for me than the A-side. Obviously, she's done with it what she wanted to do with it. I presume she has some control over how her records sound. So it must be the way she wants it, which is fine. That's great, as long as it is the way she wants it, and it's not some producer putting his own feelings about it on tape.
Julian, did you enjoy the psychedelic video?
I can't get over it. Why am I asked to talk about this rubbish, really? I mean, it's contemptible. It's promosexual rubbish. You know, it looks like trims from just one more Cornetto ad stuck together with a few old video tricks. What's it all about?
How long can people get away with videos like that, then?
Not long, on the basis of that.
But there are an awful lot of them about.
Too many, yeah. I mean, I think in America there are signs that MTV are beginning to... the audience is beginning to regurgitate the diet of, you know, whatever it is. Mainly masturbatory guitar heroes over there. But I think they'll do the same here when they get exposed to that kind of stuff all night.
But now that every song's got to have a video to go with it to get itself on television, isn't there going to be a danger that the quality of videos could get even worse?
I think it definitely will. It is getting worse. The more that are being made, the worse they're getting. Because people don't take the time to actually use it in the way that they do when they record a song. I think they give a lot more thought to the way they record a song than they make a video like that.
What about this as a song?
I don't personally see the point of doing a Beatles song. I mean, who remembers the Beatles?
Mark?
Well, that might be a good reason for doing a Beatles song, but I think this sort of... the way it's been done, it's got a really sort of beautiful, seductive treatment, like a shimmering sort of whirlpool. And I disagree about the video as well. I think the video is really great.
It?
Yeah, I love it. I think it's really, really great.
Why?
Well, I just think it's sort of it's just very beautiful and very soft and very, well, sort of psychedelic, yes. And then there'll be sort of, no doubt, lots of jokes about sort of Susie's been taking bad acid, etc. But the big two fingers up to those people.
Why did they go to Venice? Because
they were there at the time, sort of.
Why didn't they make more of Venice? Why did they use it?
I think
they
made quite a lot of Venice.
I thought the gondola
was there.
Great.
And I got a really good feeling from about
of
it.
Canals,
you know.
Nothing.
Has Venice got anything to do with the song, do you think?
Well, I think it reflects the sort of the tones and the music
sinking,
and
right,
the sound,
the
sort of very shimmering sort of very romantic sound
Mark,
to it.
You were nodding when I was talking about the B-side. You like the B-side too?
Oh, yeah, it's great, yeah. I mean, yeah. I think the Banshees are one of the only, about the only band, I'll stick my neck out and say that, the only band in this country to have reached their sort of sixth, seventh album and still be vital, fresh, innovatory and exciting, and also very enigmatic. There's no band more enigmatic than the Banshees, and I think the video is great. I think they take such a lot of care about their visuals in their sleeves and their videos and the way they put themselves across. They're a very visual band, and then sooner more people realise that, the better, and they should be number one.
Right.
So two fingers up to anyone else who disagrees.
Julian, Mark, and Annabelle, thank you very much indeed.